Alright, hello everyone. Welcome back to Summoner. I am SIMSteven, also known as Master Fenral. And today I think we're going to finish up with exploring Iona, and then we're going to go straight into the catacombs after that. So, let's get it going. So, this staircase is just beyond where we got the key from Brother Ovard before. And, wow, it's a long ways down when you look at it from this angle. But yeah, we didn't go this way. Instead, I had to do that little visual gag before. We took Rosalyn out to the world map and, did some grinding to get her level up to speed with the rest of the group. But either way, at the top of the staircase, there is Sister Bilan of Nahul. The nomad kingdom of Nahul lies on the northern steps of Orenia. My father was revered among his people as a holy man, Orenia. When Rod came to power, he enslaved his people to rebuild the Tower of Ella. My father spoke out against him. Spoke out. No man should be slave to another, my father said. No man may claim dominion over heaven. And for this, the soldiers tortured and murdered him. Ooh. Well, we already kind of knew that Murad was a very brutal emperor for torching villages just to find one boy. But anyways, what did you do? One of my father's disciples took me into hiding. I knew I would not be safe so long as Murad ruled, and so he brought me here. He knew no one would ever harm me under the protection of the Iona's monks. Father's disciple. The man who saved me was a medevin named Tathal. He was a wanderer, and I do not know whether he is alive or dead. Alive or dead, if you should meet him on your journey, give him the scroll. Alright, so apparently we're giving stuff away from the monastery to other people. First, the, the Tome of Ganis. Some monk gave it to us and told them, take this book out of Iona and give it to someone else who you'll meet later, and they'll mention the book by name. But that was kind of weird that he would have the foresight to do something like that and give it to us. Apparently we're going to be giving that book to someone much later in the game, and there's nothing we can actually do with that quest right now. Anyways, after climbing the stairs and going through the gate, take a left and should find a guy named Brother Wid in this courtyard here. Monk trembles in his robes, his round pallid head glistens with the sheens of sweat. I am Brother Wid. They call me Wid the Terrified. I am a researcher of the scroll. I am the reader of the Scroll of Monas, which Gyarados himself reclaimed from the drowned city. Scroll of Monas. In the scroll, there stood a gnarled tree, dark with 100 ravens. I spied a beautiful maid in a gossamer robe, bearing her head in her arms. I fled from the 12-headed monster with 12 tails, writhing like snakes. Tree, maiden, monster. What? These visions haunt me to this day. I cower in a world of shadows. The world of the book becomes my world. The monks of this island go mad unless they are saved. Saved, huh? In the catacombs below the Crypt of Kings, there lies an axe of Icus. With this weapon, I could face the phantoms that haunt me. Whether I live or die, I shall be free. So yeah, it's not just a bunch of literature that you see around here on Iona and stuff that the monks read and study. It's actually kind of like if you had watched a YouTube video that had a jump scare and now it haunts him to this very day or something like that. The power of magic, after all. Anyways, this here is Novasama. In case you forgot, we had a quest early on at the entrance to Iona where we were asked to find Novasama, and here she is, right here, kind of in the back of Iona. Novas hides in the shadows, clutching a book. She nearly narrows her eyes and scowls at you. Go away, leave me alone. Are you Sama? Yes, I am. What do you want? Brother Eamon is looking for you. Is he? He mustn't find me. He mustn't learn about the book. Look. Sama glances around cautiously. Please don't tell anyone. Swear to me you won't tell anyone. I swear, I guess. Satisfied with your answer, even though I said I guess after that. Someone tells her story. I was in the abbot's tower, helping the prioress when I overheard the abbot talking upstairs. He asked the master, Ian, to return a book to the great library. The book sat on a table not far from where I worked. But when he left the tower, Master Ian forgot about his errand. And what did you do? I grabbed the book and ran after him. I wanted to call out, Master Ian, you forgot the book. Something stopped me. I stood in the courtyard, holding this book in my hand, and all I wanted to do was read it. I knew I'd be punished if I did, but I couldn't help myself. Why? Someone gives you a strange look. Only an outsider was asked such a question. For 3 years I've been a novice, and 3 more years I must wait to enter the library. 3 years! And here was my chance to have the very thing I've been waiting for all my life. Did you read it? No, not at first. I hid the book away where no one would find it. Every chance I found, I'd sneak away to look at the book, to feel the leather binding and touch the vellum pages. I watched the shifting words, but I'd not read them. Not at first. I was afraid. These words are very dangerous. Madness, despair, and death are always cursed for the mind that is unprepared. I had no power against the lure of the book. Many glyphs were strange to me, and they shifted before I had a chance to read them. Words began to burn into my mind, and I could neither sleep nor eat. In every shadow of the island, I saw phantoms of the dead, monks and knights, kings and queens, and I knew the words would kill me if I did not surrender the book. Yes, but to whom? I knew the monks would banish me, and I could not trust the others. If they made me leave, I have nowhere to go. If I cannot live on Iona, I will not live at all. Too bad for you. No. How can I help? If you can find a way to return this book to the great library, you'll save me. I'll help you. And someone gives you the book, an ancient volume bound in blood red leather, and etched with the intricate gold swirls. Tomes that weighs were carved from stone. This is the book of Granista. Bring it to the great library, and keep my secret safe. Okay, and one more thing, all the way at the end of this corridor is the Uroth feather. And this is actually part of the quest that we did last time, and the main reason why I kind of didn't quite come back here as soon as I finished leveling up Rosalind a bit. But Eldak, the Initiate, that one quest that we did last time where we were going back and forth between Madog and Jir the Elder, well, that is the feather that had been stolen from the Linnell Temple. So it finally made its way all the way here thanks to these thieves who ended up stealing it, and they kind of planted it here so that the monks would find it, and, well, they wanted to start a holy war, or at least, Elodak did. Either way, I'm just getting a little bit of a map here real quick. So, the book that Sama gave us, we have two options on what to do with it. The first is to give it to the guy who gave us the quest all the way near the entrance of the island, and you'll get 200 gold, end of quest. And he also wondered about what Sama's been up to, and it's up to you whether or not you want to actually tell. But what I actually recommend you do is talk to Brother Morhan, and sometimes, well, after we talk to Brother Morhan and give him the book, we can also go back to Sama and get additional rewards. But Brother Morhan gives you an extra 200 EXP rather than 200 gold that you would give if you return it to the guy who sent you on the quest in the first place. I forget his name off the top of my head right now, but either way, I'm sorry, Trevor. It will only take you many years to open these doors. Only monks who have sworn the oath may enter the great library. Who are you? I am Brother Morhan. I am a monk of Iona. Great Library, inside these walls we guard the pages written in the language of the gods. For all but the prepared mind, this faith leads to madness and death. Well, we got Sama's book. The Book of Garanus Da. Should be in the library. I will return it at once. But tell me, how did this book come into your possession? Now, we have a few choices we can make. We can tell him the truth. We could say we promised we wouldn't tell. We could also lie and say a monk asked me to return it. Or found it in the orchard. There are a lot of possible options, but I believe the one that we want to pick here is actually to tell the truth to Morhan, and then go back to Sama and lie and say we did not mention her name. And this should give us the biggest reward in experience points if we choose to do it this way. So we already got the 200 EXP for returning the book. And if we go back to Sama and tell her that we did not tell this guy that we mentioned her name, then we'll get an extra 100 EXP. But either way, this news saddens me. And I thought to form the abbot. I pray, Laurent, will show mercy. Though for an infraction such as this, he could banish her from the island. I thank you for returning the book. Well, we did not keep our promise. But we'll still lie to her instead, and that should give us an extra 100 EXP if we return to her and tell her the news that we did not tell him that we gave him the book. Anyway. So, have you returned the book of Granis? Ah, yes. To whom did you give the book? Brother Morhan. Brother Morhan? He's a good soul, and I trust he'll return it to the library. Did you tell him who gave you the book? No, let's do a little bit of lying here. I'm in your debt, Wanderer. You kept your word and you saved me. Maybe not. Maybe you will get what's coming to you. You should have returned it in the first place. So that's kind of on you. But either way, now I'm going to my lesson. Mother, again, will be furious with me. So we got an extra 100 EXP because we did that. Try to talk to her again and the novice ignores you. So, whatever it is, if you actually keep your word to Sama and not mention her name, and then go back to her again and say you did not mention her name, you only get like 50 EXP. But if you tell Brother Morhan that it was in Sama's possession, you'll get an extra bonus 100 EXP. And I've played this game numerous times, and I've tested pretty much all of the possible routes that you could go on that. And, well, no matter what you do, that's where the quest ends. No new developments ever happen with that quest, as far as I know. So I just suggest getting the extra 100 EXP for the quest. And not bring it back to whatever his name is at the entrance. And not go for the 200 gold. I personally would say the XP is better overall in the long run. Especially since eventually you'll run out of things to buy. And 200 gold isn't that hard to come by either way. Either way, got some books here in the binder library. And Lightning Tract, Icicle Tract. Should be the other obvious one in here somewhere. Where are you? Volume 67. So we need that for the Encyclopedia of Heresies. Fire Arrow Track. There it is. That's the Holy Trinity, I guess. Excuse me, burp. But either way. And that is the entrance to the catacombs. There should be one more scroll in here. Home of Revive. So you don't actually have to spend your money on that. And you've picked that up after you've already bought one, which I think I might have actually done. it gets eaten by how the inventory system works with tomes. But either way, Master of the Keys, I don't mean to talk to you, I don't think. Wise Monk, I think both of them just give backstory and that's it. Either way, we already have the key from Brother Ovard, so we can now enter the catacombs. So let's get things going. Also, when you hit the loading screen, The bookcase reverts back to its original state, which makes it look like it smushes you a little bit while it's loading. But either way, it'll be open when we get back out of here. But either way, let's go into the catacombs. Okay, so first and foremost, we actually have a little puzzle to start off, start things off with. Now, you could just cheese it with fleece and pick the lock on this coffin, or you could solve the puzzle properly. That is, push in all these statues, just kind of run, run in a circle. Did I? Yeah, I accidentally hit that a second time. All we gotta do to solve this really easy puzzle is just to push each of these statues in, and eventually that'll cause the coffin in the center to open up. And one more. And there we go. We can now enter the Iona Catacombs. And this dungeon is literally long. This dungeon pretty much starts down here and then pretty much all goes in a straight line with very little deviance on the way. So, yeah, let's get things going. This is going to be kind of a boring dungeon run. We're probably going to stop in the middle anyways because, well, we're up to 15 minutes already of recording time. But either way, we're pretty much going to be fighting a lot of undead enemies. So, kind of get used to how these guys are, because you'll be seeing a lot of these. At least we're inside the bones of a three-headed serpent, Vadagar's last incarnation. Little backstory there, we've heard that name a few times before. Vadagar himself is not really important to the grand scheme of things. He's just an old dead god from history. And that's really all it is. Anyway. We just killed a bone servant, I believe. And this is also a bone servant. It's actually two different kinds of bone servants in the game. There's one that actually has two heads. And then there's this guy who carries a dagger and a long sword. And it's actually something he can drop, is both a dagger and a long sword. Either way, once again, good reason to have a high lockpicking skill, because it'll just make things a little bit easier to get through this place, and you get loot whenever it drops, and sometimes it gets randomly locked, just for whatever reason. So, once again, you probably should give Fleece a very high lockpicking skill, because well, if you're a loot, you killed the monster, they shouldn't lock it up in a box, and make it so you becomes completely unobtainable. Yeah, just pick it up, pick the lock, and pick up the loot. Anyway, I probably should summon a monster, because, should summon the Blackfire Elemental, that is, just to help with a little bit more DPS here, simply because the enemies in here do not give a whole heck of a lot of EXP. And, well, it's easier, it's a lot better of an idea to just kind of cruise through this place as quickly as possible and just kind of not worry about all the XP that you won't be getting, because these guys, I don't know, if they're given like 70 or so EXP per kill, I think that means you get like 20 EXP per person. Very little EXP total. Very little MP, and the items are mostly crap as well. Well, aside from the fact that there are a few bold mages in here, and if you have not gotten the Quilted Holy Robes for Rosalyn, you might want to save scum until you get the Quilted Holy Robes. But, well, we got some out in the forest. Actually, it was on the plains at night is where we got the Quilted Holy Robes for Rosalyn. Once again, best armor she can equip at this point in time in the game. And wow, I just noticed that guy gave me 47 EXP. That's about 15 per person. And no, I'm not dividing by 4. I'm dividing by 3 because the Blackfire Elemental doesn't count. Anyways, we've already hit a diverging pathway here, a fork in the road. Pretty much the only interesting thing about this dungeon, really, is the fact that it splits into two and then meets up at near the end. It's pretty much just an oval-shaped path. So, either go left or you go right. If you go right, there are a couple bone mages down here. First one is actually right there. Once again, if you've not gotten a quilted holy robe, you might want to save scum until you get one from these guys. Just kind of save and reload until they eventually drop it, because Rosalind, once again, is paper thin with her defenses. So you'll definitely want to have it so that... don't get too far away from the group here. Don't get too far away from the group, because we need to share the EXP as much as we can. I don't like to lose out on any EXP that I could eventually get. I just like to keep everyone even. I haven't actually evened out the EXP totals for everyone, and this is actually a pretty good place to do it. Because they give so little EXP, you can get everyone pretty close to each other. And... well... when you actually gain levels, you all gain a level at the same time. And I like to spend all my skill points all at the same time. It's just kind of one of those little satisfying things that whenever you... ooh, gave me a U-ball. it's just one of those satisfying things is when everybody levels up at the same time and you get a bunch of skill points to spend all at once. It's just, I don't know, cathartic, I guess. Anyway, also they drop quilted robes. Not as good as the quilted holy robe, but still is selling fodder. And also, Rosalind doesn't come equipped with anything once you first get her. So if you come straight into the catacombs, which I don't recommend you do, you can get some armor for her here. Anyways, I realize I also missed out on a treasure chest back when we were at the fork in the road a little bit ago. But we'll be coming back there in a minute. We're just going to try and plow through all these skeletons and kind of come full circle. But there's a bone you can walk on, and it goes to a hidden room up high. And up there, you can actually get, I think it's the last shard of the Gamati, if I'm not mistaken. So we can get the final shard there and finish that quest later, once we get back to Linnell. Same thing for the Tome of Heresies. We just got volume 67 in the library a minute ago before coming in here. And we'll turn that quest in once we get back to Linnell. I think there's a few other quests that we can finish once we get to Linnell as well. I think we need to talk to a sailor later for one of the people who ended up stranded on this island or whatever. And, let's see here. This place is getting kind of cool looking. We're actually on the bones over a pit of death, I guess. I want to help Fleece kill this bowman, or this bone archer. Because the archers tend to be worse in the game as far as overall just damage they do compared to the melee classes. They just tend to attack from the range and do quite a bit of damage. Despite the fact that I don't really like bows, one thing I can say is they actually do a fair amount of damage. Also, speaking of damage, something I did when I was walking back to Iona between episodes is that Fleece herself got a new skill for chain attacks while I was kind of working my way back. She actually got blind stab. And I am about one skill away from having all of them with Fleece, which is kind of why I have desperation and stamina tech on. Once I start playing as Fleece again, in fact, I probably could work on that while we're here in the catacombs, since Rosalind is not the best right now as far as getting chain attacks. Once we get stuff to boost her speed with, maybe lighter weight staves, We might start using Rosalind a bit more, but for now, I'm going to try and get Fleece's last chain attack. Plus, it's a lot easier to hit the chain icon as well, because Fleece has high speed, so it makes it a lot easier to get the chains going. Anywho. Cross the bone. And yeah, we're just plowing through this place, because we're very well equipped and also very well leveled up as well. This place is meant to be a little bit easy for Rosalind because she's your new party member and she comes in fairly weak. So, oh, just a quilted robe. So this place is meant to be just kind of a place to get her level up a little bit. But yeah, I don't think there's anything down this way. Nope. Because the enemies give very little XP, but you also have a group of three, and skeletons tend to be very weak enemies as far as this game is concerned. So this is meant to just be a place to get her a level or two. And let's see here, nothing there. And now we're going inside the bones. So you can see there are three pathways here. Not gonna worry about all of these just yet. I think if we just take the left one, we'll go back to where we first started. And there should also be a quest item along the way there. And if we get to that quest item, we might end up actually just stopping the episode around there. It ends up being a long roundabout pathway here. If I remember right, and yeah, this little tunnel right here. Now, I think if you keep going down the hallway to the left, I believe you'll hit an altar that you'll actually need to touch later on just to access the final boss of the place, as well as the Ring of Light. So we'll be going down that way possibly in the next episode, but not today. Today we're going to go down the side path here, and it should lead us all the way back to the fork in the road. Or we could just kind of walk all the way back around and find our way back to here. It doesn't really matter how we do it. But yeah, there's this little side path here that just connects back to that fork in the road. And I may end up just... speeding this up a little bit, since it's really just a lot more of the same old, where we fight more skeletons all along the way here. Thank you. Okay, we've actually come full circle. That's where the path ends. Also, along the way, we found a treasure box that had an axe in it. If we identify the axe, it is the axe of Ickes. And it's the item that Wid the Terrified needed for his quest. So, we now have it, and I'll actually show you where it is again on the way back. But we also want to go up here, up along this bone here, which this is the one that I mentioned earlier that I missed a treasure chest a little bit ago at the start of the fork, and well, here it is. I believe this is going to be the last. Ooh, chainmail tunic. And some gold, and a health tonic. Oh, this is not where the final shard of Gamani is. Ooh. Well, either way, the chainmail tunic we can give. Do we want to give that to Joseph, or do we want to give that to Fleece? Joseph gets the magic resist bonus from the Blizzard Surcoat, which might be okay. I want to take a look at how good it looks, because the looks of my characters does matter to me. Yeah, we'll give that to Joseph for now. Requires heavy arms level 3, but also gives 40 protection. Very nice piece of armor there. Now, should I give the Blessed Surcoat to Fleece? It's 16 defense versus 20. Nah, I think I'll keep the Leather Jerkin on. I don't think we really need to worry a whole heck of a lot about, you know, taking magic damage in general, so I'll keep it so that Joseph is a bit more of a tankier and so that he can take a few more hits. Anyways, yeah, on the way back, I'm actually going to show you exactly where the axe is. So we're right here at the start of the fork, and if you were to take the left, well, there's no treasures along the right path, but if you take the left path, you can get the axe of Ickes. And there's a point in hit time here where Rosalind actually speaks out loud and says the 13 kings were buried here or something like that. And the axe itself is at the end of the first bone walkway. And we'll get to show that in just a minute here. Also, one thing I like to use here in the catacombs is Rosalind's light spell. And that's simply because this is a pretty dark and gloomy place, and this will light up the pathway so you can actually see where you're going. You don't actually have to worry about falling off because you can't do that. But it does make it easier to see where you're going. but anyways, the Axe of Ickes is just take this bone walkway around in a circle, because I guess there's a landslide over there or something that's blocking the way. You'll see, like, some structures here, and it's going to be right around here is where the axe is going to be. So, if you're looking out for that, because for the quest, then, well, that's where you'll find it. And yeah, let's go down this dark corridor here, and we're going to just end the episode kind of at the tri-split, which is where this pathway dumps us off at. And once again, it's also right where the both of these paths merge, is right at, basically it's the joint of a three-toed claw, which is a huge claw, by the way. So because we're on Vadagar, or whenever we're in the bones section of this place, we're on Vadagar himself, or the bones of Vadagar, that is. And being a giant ocean god or whatever. And the fact that he died when... Who was it? Was he the one who actually rose the island? Was Vadagar the one who rose the island up? I don't quite remember. But either way, once again, the path kind of dumps us out right here. And it actually spits us out so that we're actually facing back towards the way we came from originally. But yeah. Yeah, up there is where we originally started. And like I said, it's a long dungeon, quite literally. And this path here will actually split off into three pathways. And I think at the end of the middle talon is where the Ring of Light is going to be. But we actually have to go to the left and right paths first. And actually, you know what? If my memory serves me right, actually, I think the last Shard of the Gamani is at the end of one of these other pathways. Because there's an altar at the end of two of the paths. You have to hit both of those altars, or an orb on the altars, and that'll allow you to access the final area in the middle pathway. So we're actually going to have to go down all three paths regardless, but I think we're going to save that for the next episode. So, yeah. Once again, I am SimSteven, also known as Master Fenrel. Thanks for watching, and I will see you guys next time. I'm also going to make sure I'm fully healed before we continue, because, hell, let's make sure our mana is regenerating as we trek along those pathways. Anyways, I'll see you guys next time.